welcome you to our morning discussion with Matthew Stewart, who gave a very interesting lecture last night. I hope a lot of you had a chance to be able to attend that. If not, we'll cover some of the same ground, but not all. We're going in some different directions. His book was Nature's God, The Heretical Origins of the American Republic. My name's Paul Stewie. I am a history teacher, currently teaching advanced placement European history at Blue Valley West High School in Overland Park. So Matthew Stewart is an American philosopher, an independent scholar, and author, currently living in the Boston, Massachusetts area. He's done a number of books besides Nature's God, including The Management Myth, The Courtier and the Heretic, and The Truth About Everything. He graduated from Princeton University in 1985 with a concentration in political philosophy. He was awarded the prestigious Sachs Scholarship from Princeton and studied in Oxford University, where he received his PhD in philosophy in 1988. He then worked some time as a management consultant prior to being a full-time author. He's also married to a famous writer and journalist, Catherine Stewart, whose latest book is The Good News Club. So welcome, Matthew.
Thanks, great to be here.
History is perhaps best defined as an argument about the past, an argument based on evidence and based on research using primary resources. But is the historian who, through his or her interpretation, really makes these sources make sense and brings meaning to the subject through their intensive research and their critical thinking? Matthew Stewart brings both breadth and depth to his book, A Nature's God. It is a challenging book dealing with very complicated subjects. But he guides us through this with impeccable research and outstanding writing. He has 94 pages of footnotes, over 1,000 footnotes, and some extensive annotation. So it's clearly a scholarly work, research-driven, but is also very well written, and it can be understood by most people, I think. Now, I hadn't read the book until recently, but it clearly affected the depth to which I understood our revolutionary founders and the leaders of the modern Enlightenment. I can now engage my students in a deeper understanding of the Age of Reason and the American Revolution. So, from my understanding of the book, that Stewart's thesis or argument goes something like this, that the American Revolution is not just a revolt against an imperial monarch, but also a revolt against the global reach and oppressiveness of conventional, supernatural, or revealed religion. To put it another way, the concept of God was as revolutionary as the concept of as their politics. Or in Stewart's own words, he argues, quote, that the radical philosophy of America's founders remains the best way to explain the persistence, the power, and the prosperity of a modern liberal order around the world to this day, end quote. And also he quotes the American 18th century revolutionary, Joel Barlow, and he put it this way, quote, present is the age of philosophy, and America the empire of reason, end quote. So the book Nature's God, Stewart makes his case by interweaving a genealogy of nature's God, beginning in ancient Greece with Epicurus, through the Enlightenment thinkers with lesser-known founders like Thomas Young and Ethan Allen, through the better-known founders like Jefferson and Franklin. Whether one accepts all of his conclusions or not is an exceptional addition to our understanding of who we are, and he has been so honored with the National Book Award Longlist Nonfiction in 2014. Personally, I think this book should be required reading for all classes, college classes, in the American Revolution. So I'm going to begin with a few questions, and the first one is probably an obvious one that you've been asked many times. Why did you choose to write on this topic?
Thanks for that introduction, Paul. And I like to write about things that I don't know enough about. I have to admit it. To some degree, it's just my own curiosity that takes me on these projects. So when I started this work 10 years ago, honestly, it was because I suddenly came to the understanding that I didn't know what I thought I knew about American history and about America's philosophical heritage. So here's the particular episode that got it started, and I think I described this in the introduction, but it's true. I suppose I had the idea that the American Revolution was plain vanilla. It wasn't as interesting as the French Revolution. It wasn't as radical. It wasn't as philosophical. And then at some point, something led me to read Ethan Allen's book, Reason, the Only Oracle of Man. And there's a lesson in this, especially for your students here. Read the primary sources, because I thought I knew what I was going to be reading, and then when I read it, I realized I had no idea. I had no idea that I was going to find the stuff that I found there. Basically, what I saw there were clues that America's philosophical heritage was a lot more interesting than I had been led to believe. And so that then led to this journey where I explored it more and I saw the deeper connections. It was very rewarding. And I feel I got a PhD in American history for free. Perhaps not for free, since I suppose you had to pay for the book.
Yeah.
That I think is what really drove me, is just this desire to learn more and to figure out what it was that I didn't know.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, so you did spend so much time in doing so much research on this over 10 years, you know, and I've alluded to the amount of primary sources and that kind of thing that you dealt with. Could you tell us just a little bit how you did your research, kind of what your day was like, what you did researching, how much you did, when you would start writing, at what point in your research, that kind of thing. I think for me, someone that doesn't do this, I'm always curious when I read a volume like this, just what was the process of putting this together?
Right. Of course, I suppose I could ask my wife to sort of verify what I'm saying. She may turn out that my own perception is different. There was one formal period of library-bound research that mattered in particular, and that's when I had a fellowship at the New York Public Library. And some of the research focuses on Thomas Young in particular, and the Boston Committee of Correspondence and so on. So let's say that chapter was conventional. I think that would sort of fit your standard picture. I would go to the library in the morning. I had a little cubicle, and I'd spend time in the archives. And then spend the afternoon at the computer trying to figure out what I had just read. But setting that formal chapter aside, I'm a morning writer. That's when the sentences seem to come together. I think I'm an afternoon speaker, by the way, but I'm a morning writer. And so typically I spend the morning doing an awful lot of writing and rewriting. I mean, thanks for your compliments on the writing, but the truth is that that's because you're reading draft number 152. So there's a lot of that. And then I tend to spend the afternoons and evenings doing a lot of the reading. And here's something that has changed over the past 20 years or so that I've been doing this kind of thing. In the early days, I would have to do a lot of that reading in libraries. But you know, now the internets have really changed that pattern. So frankly, I do quite a lot of research and work just at home on the computer.
So these primary sources that you're reading, and when you want to have excerpts and stuff, do you take notes by hand? Do you use your computer? Do you talk into your phone? How do you?
So so if we talk just about the chapter of archival research, there's the New York Public Library, also Massachusetts Historical Society, and a number of others. You know, that's kind of fun, but it's also a small part. And there, I think it's a question of just taking notes by hand, because you're dealing with these old documents.
Right.
And some of them are quite fascinating. I mean, I'm not sure if I mentioned this in the book, or maybe it's in one of the notes. I discovered that Thomas Young actually wrote a certain part of this famous Boston pamphlet, the sort of first draft of the Declaration of Independence. And I discovered this just by looking at his handwriting, because he didn't sign it, but it was clear that it was his handwriting. And that's something that I discovered just by going through the archives. But for the other research, I don't think I have any particular magic. I mean, mm-hmm. I tend to use computer notes, because that way I can cut and paste
right.
and so on.
Right.
But it is important to take notes, and so I do have, hundreds of pages of little excerpts or little brilliant thoughts. And there again, I think that the important issue is triage, because there's 152 brilliant thoughts, and it turns out that only two of them actually are worth including in the book.
When I talked about the breadth of your work, the fact that you look at these radical philosophers in the American Revolution, and you don't just look at the Enlightenment thinkers, you go way back to ancient Greece, and you had a graphic last night at your presentation, kind of a tree of this genealogy, and you spend a chapter going into this genealogy of these radical revolutionary philosophers or thinkers didn't just come up with this. You kind of trace it back. Could you give us kind of a shortened version of that genealogy, that process going back to Epicurus and how it progressed through the early modern period?
Sure. Well, one advantage that I think I have in terms of the way I carry on my research and work is that I'm unemployed. So I'm not part of an existing discipline. And that gives me a tremendous amount of freedom. So I think if I had been within an academic department, I probably would have been compelled to sort of write this as early modern philosophy and stick within that chapter. But there's another important aspect to the project, and that's that I think I was following the lead of some of the subjects that I was studying. So Thomas Jefferson, for example, was not confined to any one period. And one way that, in fact, I pursued the project was to just look at what Thomas Jefferson was reading, because he cataloged it all. You can go to the Library of Congress and you'll see, his list of books. You can check them out. You can actually look at the books that he owned. And they go over a very wide range of subjects. So to some degree, the genealogy was directly inspired by Jefferson. So I suppose to talk specifically about the genealogy, I put a lot of emphasis on the ancient origins of some of these ideas. And that comes from my own background, my own reading. I've always felt, in a way, most comfortable with ancient philosophy. It seems to me the most honest or authentic. But I was also following Jefferson, because he says at a critical point in a beautiful letter, "I too am an Epicurean." So for me, that was a tremendous gift, because it kind of validated my own interest in ancient philosophy, but it also showed me that those ancient connections were very important. I think it's because the problems that humanity faces, they have been around before. The ancient world was interesting, it was complex, it was sophisticated. It developed these really advanced ways of thinking about the human condition. And it then those ideas then played a really vital role in getting civilization, let's say, restarted or re-energized in the early modern period. It was the recovery of some of that, those ideas and the challenges that represented, that I think got the Renaissance going and got the early modern philosophers really thinking. And I guess the one specific access that I think is central is the role that Epicurean materialism played in getting people like Bruno and Hobbes and Vanini to really question what they learn and come up with new and very important ways of thinking about the world. We could go on for a long time about the specific characters, but...
Well, you, of course, focus a lot on this term that maybe we don't have a full understanding of, and that is deism. And I think you've given us some new insight into kind of the conventional wisdom of what deism meant during the 18th century in America. Could you talk a little bit about your interpretation of what deism really was?
Sure, and it's, in a way, deism is one of those misleading labels that throws us off the scent when we first approach the American Revolution. Because I think it's understood, I mean, even in junior high school, you're kind of taught that you know, the founders were deists in some sense. Here are the problems, or here's where you need to make it go a little deeper. First, if you examine the way in which deism is talked about and discussed in its historical context, it's not primarily a theology. It's not primarily a doctrine about a deity. So if you summarize it now in the classroom, it'll be something like, well, there's God. He created the world in a moment, designed it almost perfectly, and then more or less walked away, or perhaps came back to make a few little adjustments in the clock. But if you look at it in context, what you see is that it's not just a theology, but a certain understanding of ethics. It's also a certain kind of epistemology or a theory of knowledge where we can actually get our information from. And then it also connects in a really important way with a political theory. And it connects in particular, I think, with the kind of natural rights political theory that powered the American Revolution, ideologically speaking. So it's much broader than just a theology. I suppose that's the first important point. Another important point is that it's often represented as a kind of the wateriest form of Protestantism. It's typically seen as a the slippery slope that as you go down from Unitarian to Socinian to something even more extreme, you end up with deism. And while I think there's a certain psychological validity to that, and there are certainly some figures in history who follow that line, in fact, the core ideas of deism really come from this ancient philosophical tradition that was always at odds with the Christian tradition, that was not part of Protestantism, but was in fact resisting it from the beginning. And the final point I'll say about deism is that we think of it as a religion. We think of it as something that clearly shows that these people were conventional and pious. But when you read it in context, the most common synonym for deist in the American colonial period is infidel. Seriously, I mean, those two words are used in conjunction almost all the time. He's a deist, an infidel, whatever, it's the same thing. So you have to understand that kind of tension in order to make sense of the history. Mm-hmm. Should I go on, or?
That's a good start. We'll segue. Speaking of infidels, as a historian, one of the things I think that you really added to our knowledge was telling us about this guy named Thomas Young, who was kind of self-described as a deist, and that was something I had not heard of before, or I don't think probably any of us had heard of Thomas Young before. So could you talk about him just a little bit? Because a fascinating character in American history, and why we don't know about him.
Exactly. I mean, I like to say that everybody deserves a forgotten founding father, because we all need to identify with some figure in the Revolution, and he's mine. So I'll tell you how I found Thomas Young. So I came across Ethan Allen's book. And then, reading about it, I saw this theory, which was more or less accepted as the fact, that Ethan Allen did not write his own book, that in fact he was too stupid, too uninformed to have written this book, which clearly borrowed so much from the preceding history of philosophy, and that the real author was his friend Thomas Young. And so when I began the project 10 years ago, I thought, oh, well, that sounds like a good, conspiracy story, a buddy story. You know, one guy writes the book, the other one publishes it, and so on. And I thought I'd do a nice big expose. And as I did the research, I came to the conclusion that the theory was just wrong. Ethan Allen did write his own book. It's true that he relied on Thomas Young for the insight, but Ethan Allen wrote his own book.
And that's what historians were telling us, that he didn't write his own book.
Right.
A lot of historians were saying no. You know, and not just average people, but people that had studied it.
Right. And I think that also reveals a certain set of assumptions about, mm-hmm. you know, what self-taught mountain men can do. It also reveals a certain set of assumptions that should be questioned about how philosophy gets transmitted. But to go back to Thomas Young, that story didn't work out, but I was grateful to it because it introduced me to Thomas Young. So here's a snapshot, and I'll tell you what he did, and then you tell me why you haven't heard of him. So he was born in upstate New York in 1731. By the time of the Stamp Act riots, which, as you know, were critical in getting the revolutionary movement going, he was a leader of the Sons of Liberty in Albany. So he played a key role in the riots or protests that were going on there, and he inspired the riots that went on in New York City. So a crucial role in 1765 already. He then moves to Boston to get involved in the revolutionary movement there. He becomes a leading figure in the Boston Committee of Correspondence, which, as John Adams said, was one of the great engines of the revolutionary movement. He then gets involved in writing specific aspects of it, driving it, and he gets involved in the Tea Party. And while Samuel Adams was clearly the sort of lead or main public figure in the movement, it seems clear that Thomas Young had a really vital role behind the scenes and also in front. And in fact, he was, I checked this out in the archival research in London, if you go through some of the testimony that's there that was presented to the English Lords when they investigated this fiasco of the Tea Party, it's clear that the first person to stand up in the Boston town meeting and say, we need to throw the tea in the harbor, was Thomas Young. So this is the man who essentially kicked off the Tea Party. But that's just the start of his revolutionary career. Then he moves to Philadelphia, and he makes friends with Thomas Paine, and he gets involved in the Pennsylvania Revolution. Now here's another chapter of the American Revolution that, you know, I learned about in the course of this work and that should be better known. The Declaration of Independence only happened because there was this revolution in Pennsylvania that tilted the balance in the Continental Congress toward independence. Who was behind this revolution in Philadelphia and Pennsylvania? Well, it was Thomas Young and Thomas Paine and a couple of other of their friends. They then produced the first modern democratic constitution for the state of Pennsylvania, the Pennsylvania Constitution of 1776. This was really a first draft of the U.S. Constitution, arguably more democratic in a way, more, let's say, universal and egalitarian than the actual Constitution we ended up with for the United States. And this Constitution was significant enough that it was brought over to France, and Benjamin Franklin passed around copies, and everyone thought it was so clever that they assumed that Franklin wrote it. But in fact, it was Thomas Young and his friends who were involved in producing this first constitution. Thomas Young then sent it off to Vermont, where the settlers there were starting to try to form a state, and he recommended it to them, and they in fact adopted a version of it for the state of Vermont. And then as a final capstone of his career, you could argue, there's a certain dispute about this among Vermont historians, I gather, but that he named the state of Vermont. Because it came from, you know, some sort of French, his idea of French for green mountain. So Thomas Young, a remarkable figure. Why don't we know about him? Why isn't he, you know, compare him with, say, Paul Revere. Mm-hmm. I mean, Paul Revere, nice guy, but, you know, what did he do? He sort of, rode the horse and the redcoats are coming.
He needs a poet.
Yeah, that's right. I guess you need a poet to back you up. Well, why don't we know about him? Well, to some degree, he's a casualty of history. There are lots of people who do interesting things, they don't get recorded. But I think the main reason is that he was a deist and an outspoken deist. And this goes back to our earlier discussion about deism, that he was forthright in his beliefs. He would speak his mind wherever he went, and he would say, I'm a deist. And that made him extremely unpopular. It made him an infidel. And so he was constantly bumping up against this outrage. And I'll just finish with one chapter from the Boston Committee of Correspondence episode. At a certain point, that committee was starting to run into resistance. There were, after all, a number of loyalists around who were not happy with all of the commotion that was being caused by this committee. And one way they decided to attack the committee was to say that it consists of a bunch of infidels, above all Thomas Young. And then the committee writes a defense, and it's a charming defense because they don't deny that Thomas Young is an infidel and a deist. They just say he's very capable, he's done a tremendous amount of work for us, and the remarkable thing about him is that he always speaks his mind. He just always tells people what he's thinking. And so he's in a way the truth teller of the philosophical part of the American Revolution. Anyway, I find him a fascinating character, and so I'm happy if other people can look into him more.
Yeah. Okay, let's kind of open it up now and address some of the questions you might have. So if you'll just raise your hand, a microphone will come around, and we'll take your question. We'll start over here.
Okay. I might have this a little bit wrong, and I haven't finished your book, so I apologize if it appears later, but Lucretius is said to have, one of his vignettes was the happiest day of his life was when he was standing on a beach, and he could look across the bay, and he could see a ship sinking and the people drowning, and he thought to himself, I'm happy because I'm not one of them, right? And it's sort of, it's a little bit weird and humorous, but it does indicate this Lucretian idea, this Epicurean idea of fortuna being in charge of events, that there is no sort of direct divine intervention. And I'm curious, since this is a worldview that informs deism, this idea of non-divine intervention, sort of the idea of spontaneous order and this sort of skepticism about direct involvement by authority, whether it's divine or human authority. So it brings to mind, as I was reading your book, it brings to mind this school of thought that is, Matt Ridley does this, a lot of libertarian philosophers do this. They present a dichotomy, two different worldviews. One is which believes in spontaneous order, let's say, and another that doesn't believe in spontaneous order, that believes that things must be directed because on Earth we ought to mimic the way divine intervention behaves, and that most human affairs need to be directed by some authority. I'm curious. Is that a fair description of this dichotomy? And do you see that dichotomy today? I sense a sympathy from your perspective, a sympathy for the deistic worldview, this spontaneous order view. Am I trying to drag too much out of your thesis, or could you maybe speak to that? Or do you have a sympathy for that end?
Well, that's great. Thanks for the question. And let me say, whatever my sympathies are, I'm more interested in what the facts are about the history. So let me make a couple of preliminary points. Lucretius and Epicurus certainly had a tremendous influence on the course of philosophical events, but that doesn't mean that every aspect of Lucretius or Epicurean philosophy then gets replicated later on. One theme that comes out in the particular passage that you're referring to is also a kind of quietism in the Epicurean and Lucretian philosophy. It's this idea that the way to happiness is basically not to care, right? I mean, it's a little more complicated than that, but part of what's going on is he's happy because he doesn't, he's not personally involved in that shipwreck. And that doesn't necessarily carry through. So there are aspects of the Lucretian package that don't follow through, even though the Lucretian Epicurean philosophy had this impact. Now, on the question of design versus spontaneity, or let's say authority from above or authority from below, I do think that that's a fundamental part of the modern revolution. I do think that now we associate that with Darwin, but that if you examine the preceding history, you will find the things that we associate with Darwin appearing at an earlier stage and usually in connection with Lucretius. So I do believe that whereas today you'll find people like, say, Daniel Dennett saying, well, Darwin was the first to come up with the idea that complex systems can evolve out of simple rules from a random beginning. That idea actually exists before. And I think that was critical to the political revolution, and it was so in this way. The basis of the philosophy that mattered for the American Revolution is that authority comes from below, that it is to some degree that whatever claims we make about justice, whatever claims we make about the correct political order, at the end of the day, they derive their legitimacy and their power from the people themselves. And what that involves contesting or always fighting against is the notion that the authority in fact comes from above, that there is some source in the sky that comes down and tells us how we should order our lives. That's what they're challenging, and that's, I think, the core message behind deism as I'm interpreting it. Now, to throw in some more complexity, by the way, you could also point out that some ways of interpreting deism make it look more like a top-down authoritarian position, because you could say, ah, well, deism involves a deity who orders the world. But what I maintain is that, in fact, if what your deity is doing is just establishing the laws of nature, those laws of nature ultimately tell you that the authority is coming from below, that we essentially we're generating order out of complexity when we create the political order, and that has to be sort of done with the raw material of people and of, you know, our own, you know, ability or inability to understand. So it's a very important abstract theme. And I guess if I can leave you with one thing, it's just don't let the history of philosophy get too easily broken up into periods so that you'd then leave the American Revolution on one side. I think that this is one of my pet projects is to, by recovering some of the ancient philosophy, I want to show that a lot of these ideas that we think of as being distinctly modern, they've been around for a long time, and the issue is more about putting them to use and making them part of a new political order.
Thanks.
So you name your book The Heretical Origins of the American Republic, and I understand you talk about Ethan Allen and Thomas Young, especially like Thomas Young being a founder, but also being a very outspoken, atheist type of deist. But then there were also the majority of founding fathers who also were definitely probably deists, but they were more church going, more in tune with society. So I guess the question is, how would you draw the distinction between, a complete, atheist deist and, that was completely heretical in nature, and, the church-going deist, and why would you group, the entire American Revolution as, heretical?
Okay, that's a great question. I guess you're one of Paul's students,
yes.
Right? Thanks, and I appreciate that you have been burdened with reading my book. I think that's wonderful. So this is really an important theme that I'd like to get across in the book. When we look at the history of thought, I think there's a tendency to try to take the thought of a few people and generalize for thinking of an entire period. There'd probably be a good Latin expression for this kind of error. It's a synecdoche, I guess, of some sort, where you say, well, here's what a few people thought, so therefore all Americans at this time period thought the same thing. And I think that's fundamentally incorrect. The thinking at any particular time is always incredibly diverse. It always includes lots of oppositions and lots of contraries. So in the case of the heretical aspects of the American Revolution, or its radical founders, its radical subset of founders, I hope none of what I'm saying is mistaken to be saying that all Americans at the time were heretical, or even that most of America's founders were. It's clearly only a subset who can be called deists, and within that a subset who are sort of genuinely radical and so on. So then you might ask, well, why, you know, why is it important? And as you ask, why call the whole revolution heretical? And here's the case that I'd like to make. There are really two parts of the revolution that are interesting to us. There is, as Paul mentioned, the kind of American part, the local historical part. This is, you know, patriots running around in tri-corner hats and so on and throwing tea into the harbor. And then there's a revolutionary part of the revolution. And that may be quite a small part. It's just the part that changes the way in which people organize themselves, the way in which human beings organize their political existence. So the case I want to make is that if you want to understand that revolutionary part, you have to go through this deist or heretical philosophy, because that's what explains the logic of the revolutionary part. Now, you may then ask, well, why is it that everybody didn't share this view? And here's what I think is very interesting about the heretical deist project that created modernity. It's that they figured out a way of packaging this radical program in a way that would make it acceptable, not as offensive as it might have been, not as controversial as it might have been, to people who had a, let's say, a wider range of more conventional beliefs. So that means that you have a large group of people who have may have been effectively acting in a way that functionally makes them heretics, even though nominally, if you go and inspect, you know, what they believed and you try to figure out whether they went to church or not, you might not come to that same conclusion. And so I'll give you three examples to close it up. Thomas Young, I think, is a good representative of someone who just speaks his mind and is articulating this kind of heretical project. Benjamin Franklin is a good example of a church-going deist. I think he's arguably fundamentally more radical than Thomas Young even. I think, you know, there's a good case that Franklin was just an outright atheist. But he's also much more careful about camouflaging what he says. He gives donations to churches. He goes to church and sits in the back rows because it's nice and cool on a rainy Sunday or whatever. So he's an example of a church-going deist. And then you could look at someone like Washington, who's not a philosopher. You don't really know what he's thinking. And you could argue till the cows come home about what his true religion is, and you'll never really get a complete answer. But if you examine his function, his role in the history, the part he plays, it ends up being part of this radical program. And I mean that, I'll just mention two things about Washington. One is, as we all know, his most important contribution was to step aside, right? Here was someone who could have been the monarch, and by stepping aside, he essentially said that this is a government of laws before people. And that is, I think, part of the original project. And the other thing is that Washington was very committed to the idea that we have entered an age of enlightenment and we've left the age of gloomy superstition behind us. So he was very committed to the basic freedoms that were part of the constitutional package, and that way made a decisive contribution. So whether he ends up, whether you classify him as some sort of lukewarm latitudinarian Protestant or a kind of wishy-washy deist, becomes a little bit less important. What's more important is figuring out what really powered the revolutionary part of the revolution. But thanks for your question.
Next. Okay, over here.
Hello. I have not read your book, and I will do so. But my first question, is there anyone here, a student from the School of Religious Studies? Okay. I have a few questions. First of all, I'm a lay person. I'm interested in ethics and religion. And I would like to know if you submitted your book for review by the Daughters of the American Revolution?
No, I don't think so.
Okay. As far as I'm a little nervous because I'm not a public speaker, so.
Oh, that's all right. Okay. Sometimes the publishers will send the book out to various people, so.
Okay. Do you know where the gravesite of Thomas Young is located, and anything around that ceremony or the inscription on his headstone?
Do you know?
No, I don't. Okay.
Because Thomas Young was basically lost to history, more or less. I mean, his family stuck around, and some of them cherish the memory of Thomas Young, but he died in 1777 of yellow fever while he was taking care of soldiers in the Continental Army. And he was essentially forgotten. Nobody, took the trouble. So to my knowledge, there is no known tombstone for him. There was an Ethan Allen. Ethan Allen was a true friend to the end. So after Thomas Young died, his wife was left penniless, and they had six children. So Ethan Allen went to the Vermont legislature and asked them to provide some money for the widow. And I think they did provide some, but that was the sad ending for Thomas Young.
I've been involved in genealogy the past year, and I've traced my ancestry to Jonathan Edwards. Are you familiar with the works of Jonathan Edwards?
Yes.
Okay. Princeton. So I was wondering if you've considered his works.
I did, and I do. They're clearly very important if you want to understand the evolution of religion in America in the colonial period. So for those of you who don't know, Jonathan Edwards was perhaps the first key figure in the First Great Awakening in the 1730s, and he was in Northampton, and his work started a revival there that then spread like wildfire, and people like George Whitefield, the great evangelical preacher, came over. Edwards and Thomas Young have an interesting connection. Or at least there's an interesting connection between Thomas Young and that Great Awakening. So Thomas Young was in upstate New York around the time of the First Great Awakening, and he records, it's touching to see, but in the Boston newspapers, you can see him offering these personal confessions where he says, when I was 8 years old, I felt I was born again. I went through this experience. I listened to the message of the preachers, and I thought I was going to hell, and I prayed to make sure that I would be saved. And while it's not absolutely certain that he heard Jonathan Edwards, he certainly would have heard either Edwards or one of his close colleagues preaching there. But in the end, Thomas Young rejected that. He after going through a phase where he saw himself as this creature of the revivals, he later on said, I just can't believe in that deity. I don't believe in this Calvinist deity who sort of condemns large parts of humanity to hell. And so that experience, in a way, defined him negatively, and his rejection of that. And I think the same thing happened for a number of other of America's founders. Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Paine, they all had these early encounters with this kind of religion, and they were among those people who sort of heard that and then moved in exactly the opposite direction.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think just to follow up and raise your hand for the next question. When you were talking about Thomas Young, for those who haven't read your book, two things. One was his premature death, if you can talk about what happened. And something I don't know that's been mentioned yet is that he was a physician. And the link that you make, I think, is pretty interesting in your book between physicians at that time and radicals. And if you could talk about his death first and then kind of link this kind of radical philosophy to a lot of these individuals who were, not medical school trained doctors, but self-trained doctors.
Yes, well, that's a really interesting subset. Again, a a curious discovery along the way. So Thomas Young, you know, with no background, but a smart boy, you know, very interested in learning, medicine was an option for him. And in those days, you didn't go to medical school, you would work as an apprentice. It turns out that an awful lot of doctors were involved in the American Revolution. So it's not that there were only doctors, but doctors disproportionately ended up siding with the revolutionaries and played disproportionate roles. So Benjamin Rush is I suppose, one well-known example, but there are a great many other. And I have some statistics in the book. I can't remember them off the top of my head, but you know, a significant number of participants in the Continental Congress and other important activities, a disproportionate percentage were doctors. So to go back to Thomas Young and try to explain this link, well, one aspect of it is, interestingly enough, the Dutch connection. So the mm-hmm. Dutch were important in medicine, and Thomas Young studied with a Dutch doctor. It turns out that many of these Dutch authorities on medicine were also quite radical in their philosophy. So basically being an advanced figure in the field of medicine in the 17th and 18th centuries typically meant that you were a pretty advanced figure in philosophy as well. And very often, what you were calling medicine was actually a form of philosophy. And by the way, it probably was not all that good for you. I mean, a lot of their practices were not good. But the philosophy was really quite radical. It generally was quite materialistic. It involved looking at the body as a set of pumps and levers, you know, in a very mechanical way. And I guess I would submit that if there's a reason for this connection, it has to do with that. It has to do with the philosophy of the medicine, and in particular, its very rationalist, materialist angle that made these doctors question many of the ideas with which society was organized and to look for new, more rationalist solutions. And certainly that describes Thomas Young, because you can see quite clearly as you read his many newspaper pieces that his medical ideas are also making him rethink society, making him look for a kind of cure for the problems of social justice.
What was the disease that killed him? Do you remember?
I think it was yellow fever. Yellow fever, yeah, yeah. I believe, yeah. Which I guess was pretty common with the troops.
Yeah. Because he was administering to the troops and caught something and died. Yeah, good. Okay, other questions? Raise your hand.
Yeah. I have a question, if I'm
allowed. Okay.
So my question is kind of generally about the concept of the occult, which was also sort of a big thing in the 18th century. And a lot of, you know, Enlightenment thinkers were both, you know, both are viewed as being kind of these super rational, you know, like, gloomy superstition out the door, but there are also people who are actively involved in secret societies and, you know, really interested in, kind of just what we've lumped into the occult, seances and, you know, kind of weird pseudoscience and all of that. So I'm wondering how you sort of are putting the kind of rationality of the Enlightenment thought of the founding fathers with a lot of that kind of impulse to also be involved in the occult and kind of these what we would consider to be not particularly rational ideas.
Right. Well, so as you know, people like Isaac Newton had these really weird fetishes, and I'm not sure if he counts as quite occult, but certainly has many beliefs that we would characterize as being pretty obviously irrational. He also lived in a room that was all red curtains or something like that. So there's a lot of weirdness in these figures. I don't think I grapple with that very effectively, to be honest. I think to some degree it's easy to characterize some of these early figures as irrational with the benefit of the knowledge that we have, but that if you put yourself in their context, it doesn't look quite as crazy. And I think you also have to ask yourself, is this just a curiosity? Is it a curiosity that, you know, Newton is doing, you know, bizarre genealogies of biblical figure is, with the idea that he can get to the core truth of the Bible. Is it a curiosity, or does it in fact say something vital about his science and his project? And I guess I lean to the view that it's more of a curiosity and less central to the project, but it's certainly there. And by the way, I often get asked also about the Freemasons, and so before you ask, I'll just say I don't really have that much on that either. I mean, I think it's quite plausible to maintain that Freemason societies were very important in transmitting some of these ideas. It's also the case that some of the philosophers who were involved in sort of thinking up the Freemason project were very important in the history of ideas. So John Toland, for example, not a figure that we talk about much today, but if you're looking for a single figure who pulls together the strands from radical continental philosophy and then brings them to England and puts them in a package that is really important for carrying the revolutionary project forward, it's gotta be John Toland. And he was also the individual who wrote out a sort of faux liturgy for the Masons, and you know, wrote out some sayings that possibly are still being used. I don't know, you know, like the earth is my mother and the sun is my father and things like that. But if we take him as an example, then what looks to us to be occult and bizarre and ritualistic is actually just a coded way of carrying on the Enlightenment project. It's still incredibly subversive. And it still has the basic message of asking people to think about, in terms of laws and reasons, by getting them to focus on nature.
Okay. Over here.
I wanted to maybe take it back to the doctor's connection, and I will sort of muddle trying to find a meaningful question as I speak here, but I was struck by your discussion about the doctors, particularly Benjamin Rush, and how the correspondence between Rush and Priestley and Jefferson and leading to Jefferson's Bible and this, you know, sort of Republic of Letters, Enlightenment Project, skepticism about, you know, divine authority in particular. I was struck by your one vignette of Ethan Allen being inoculated by, you know, being inoculated in the streets for smallpox. And that this sort of, I think the city selectmen, or you know, basically the authorities, the civil authorities at the time, were so vehemently against it to the point of, you know, ultimately trying to haul Allen into prison, was because basically they were making the argument that they were stepping away from the authority of God in a way, that the sort of traditional Puritan strand, Calvinist strand of politics suggested that, you know, divine intervention and retribution manifested itself in disease, in smallpox, in these plagues and so forth, and that was why they had to confront this phenomenon that challenged not only God's authority but their civil authority as well. Again, I'm left sort of, I don't really have a specific question, but I feel like there's a linkage there that maybe you could help flesh out.
Yeah, thanks, and thanks for bringing up that story. I mean, that was another one of those stories that I thought was just amusing and seemed to reflect a lot of things. It's a complicated story, so I'll just, for the people who haven't read it, I'll describe it briefly. So smallpox inoculation was controversial, but you can't quite say that it divides along religion versus enlightenment lines. There are actually some good arguments for not doing inoculation, because inoculation could spread disease. And there's also an argument about just doing it in a controlled fashion. And also, by the way, the first inoculations in America came from in Boston, and I believe it was Cotton Mather, the preacher, also associated with the witch trials, who introduced the practice in Boston along with some doctors. And then there were doctors who opposed it because they thought it didn't work. So it's a complicated basket of issues, but with Ethan Allen and Thomas Young, in some ways it was pretty boiled down to a simple thing. You had a town authority whose authority came from on high that said, you shall not inoculate. And Ethan Allen and Thomas Young said, inoculation will save our lives. It's good science, and we're going to do it. And we can take the law into our own hands on this topic. It's sort of my body, my choice, I guess. And so they did this inoculation, and then they did it flagrantly, like in public. They didn't do it in a back room. They sort of went into town square and, you know, went through this process, which involves, you know, cutting open a little pustule of someone who's infected and dragging a bit of the pus over into Ethan Allen's body and getting the antibodies that way. And it was, I think it's emblematic of a couple of a number of really interesting things. One is, yes, there are people saying that we're the source of authority, not the town. So there's this conflict between the people and the authority. There's also science against religious superstition, because notwithstanding the complexities, there was this big contingent of people who opposed inoculation just because they thought it was interfering with the divine plan, that if God wanted you to die of smallpox, well, then you should, that's what should happen. So it represents that. And I think also it says something about the characters of these two individuals, which is interesting about the American Revolution. I mean, revolutions are made by misfits, and these were two misfits. So it's an interesting story, I think, at that level. And as far as the doctors go, well, I think you see similar things going on in other cases. Again, there's some complexity, and sometimes it backfires spectacularly. I mean, Benjamin Rush seems to have been a kind of fanatical character. He was absolutely committed to the practice of letting blood out as a way of curing diseases, and also of giving people mercury, which we now use as an insecticide. Or actually, we don't even use it as an insecticide. It's terrible. And so during the yellow fever epidemic in the 1790s in Philadelphia, there's a good case we made that he killed about 4,000 people, because he went around, you know, from one infected person to another, letting out their blood, and in the process giving them yellow fever. So it's a very complicated, messy picture, but some of the themes that come out, I think, are very interesting.
Who's next? Okay, over here.
This is a broader question. It doesn't pertain exactly to that time period, but when you mentioned that Young died of yellow fever at an early age, it seems to me that there are always people in all ages that make an argument about it was meant to be, and everything happens for a reason. What would be the philosophical answer to those questions? I never know what to say when people say those things to me. What is the philosophical answer?
Yeah, well, you're getting at the question of providence, which is central to this period, and also to our own thinking. There are many different philosophies, so there's no philosophical answer per se, but I'll tell you what these revolutionaries we're talking about were thinking, and I think it's a credible answer. They would say that the kinds of reasons you're looking for can never apply to individual lives. So there may be a reason for everything, but that would only operate at a very general level in the, you know, in the basic structure of the universe. And they would call it a kind of general providence. But so long as you imagine that there is, that the world operates according to some these sets of higher reasons, then it follows that there can be no exceptions. And so if you're looking for a reason of this general type that will explain why this particular person died of yellow fever on this day, you'll never find it. Not only will you never find it, but to imagine that that's the case would be to imagine, strangely enough, what they would say is that would make you an atheist. Because then you would imagine that there is a deity who does intervene and who's able to stop people from getting yellow fever, but who turns around and actually gives them the yellow fever. So I suppose their philosophical answer is it's not going to be very comforting, but it's that no, for particular lives, there is no reason. You just have to take comfort in the knowledge that the whole operates according to some reasons, but that for precisely that reason, there is no reason for these specific things.
Front.
So I guess, like, after reading your book, for the most part, the underlying thesis is obviously that the revolution is a large rejection also of institutional religion and things like that, and you present a lot of evidence to support that as well. And I do largely agree with your thesis. My question then goes on to be, like, I just want to know how you would respond to this when prompted with, like, the next 100 years of after the Declaration and things like that, and even prior to that, when individuals like Ethan Allen and Thomas Young existed, like, institutions within the colonies of the United States then also supported things such as, like, with savage colonization of people like the Native Americans, which later then spread their own Christian ideals. So if, like, the fundamental thesis is that American Revolution is also largely based on a rejection of religion, yet though by colonizing people like the Native Americans, savagely expressing Christian religion on them, like, I guess, how does the thesis uphold in a world of that era of colonization as well?
Right, that's a great question, because after all, anybody who says that something important or significant happened in the American Revolution has to then explain why so many bad things came afterward. And my position is that this revolutionary part of the revolution is in some ways a very small part in terms of what actually happens in the history. It's just changing a certain fundamental piece of things. But much of the rest of the world goes on, and it goes on in a way that can be incredibly destructive. So another way to say it is that this revolutionary part of the revolution is always just a promise, it's an ideal, and we are constantly, it's the magnet towards which we, you know, get pulled back, hopefully, from time to time, but it doesn't stop a lot of bad things from happening. On the other hand, I think I can use it to explain some of the subsequent developments in American history. So, yes, we had, let's say, the genocides and slavery in particular. And I think there's a tendency today to say, well, since slavery followed the American Revolution, therefore the American Revolution is to be blamed for slavery. My own feeling is that slavery was there, and it was not gotten rid of by the American Revolution. It then evolved into something even worse in the years following the revolution. The institutions that we had were not able to grapple with that problem. When it finally reached a point where it was unsustainable, and we had this war, the most horrible war in American history, if you look for the core that made that war have at least a slightly positive result, at least got rid of slavery in name, even if it left behind many legacies of slavery, if you look for that part, I would say it comes from that same revolutionary part of the American Revolution. So, yes, it's true that many bad things happen, but I think it would be a mistake to say that they happened because we had this radical, heretical program, this concept of natural equality and so on. I think that in the end proved crucial in overcoming these, to the extent that we were able to, in overcoming these great tragedies in American history.
So this question kind of goes back to, like, how Ethan Allen and Thomas Young were kind of like... So this question is kind of going back to, like, how Ethan Allen and Thomas Young were kind of like the anomalies in society. So, like, do you think, was Ethan Allen a deist or atheist because he believed in extraterrestrial life? Or do you think knowing about extraterrestrial life led him to be a deist or atheist?
Right, good question. So was he an alien, a UFO buff first? Or formally speaking, Ethan Allen is not an atheist. I mean, he's committed. He's not going to let go of his deity. My guess is that the alien stuff comes afterwards, and it's an explanation or an articulation of his theological and philosophical vision. So the as I was explaining in the talk last night, the alien hypothesis is not really scientific. It's sort of scientific because it draws on Isaac Newton and, you know, the field of astronomy, but really it's just an inference. It's, well, if there are these stars up there and they have planets, then they've probably got alien life. that just turn, I think, ends up being just a way of expressing the more fundamental idea that the universe is infinite, eternal, and operates everywhere according to natural laws. And that's the core conviction, and that's what Ethan Allen is working around, and the aliens help reflect that. And they also serve him in particular as a way of dealing with his visceral hatred of some of the evangelical religion that was coming around at his time. I mean, he was another one who went through this anti-conversion process where he just couldn't deal with the whole original sin stuff. And one of his big refutations was, well, what about the aliens? Are they all going to hell? Are they guilty of original sin? So I think that they served to express these issues more than to catalyze them, I guess, the way I'd put it.
Okay, over here.
I guess I'd like to follow up on a question I asked you last night about, after your talk last night, it relates perhaps to the astronomical vision you were just referring to. Scientists nowadays speak of dark matter as being far more significant than the visible matter, the detectable, well, I guess the detectable. I guess what I'm suggesting is that there is something comparable in the history of ideas, particularly in the intellectual history of the United States. There's a dark matter out there which is the anti-intellectual strain. And I don't just mean non-intellectual, anti-intellectual. And you mentioned last night, and it's my understanding that this was not only relevant today, but was very much active then, during the revolutionary period as now. So I guess I'd like to give you just an opportunity to elaborate a little bit on that. And there is an important, because you mentioned last night, you thought to some extent it's just human nature. I think that's a cop-out, because I don't think that explains anti-intellectual. I think anti-intellectual is an ideology. It's better not to learn. If you would like to elaborate on that, I'd sure love it.
Yeah, well, I think it's a really big and important topic. So stream of consciousness here, just to elaborate more on the claim that it has a long history. We've already brought up one example in our discussion here. I mean, the smallpox issue was, for many people at the time, approached with this kind of anti-intellectual fervor. So we don't want to know about your cures. We don't, the knowledge is bad. Lightning rods. That was literally Benjamin Franklin's lightning rods. That was a subject of controversy, right? You'd think that everyone would be good with the idea of keeping thunderbolts off the roof, but no, there actually was a significant contingent that didn't want to know about that program. So it certainly has this long preceding history. On the issue of whether it comes from human nature, I think what I want to say is that it's comes from human nature in a modern context. So I don't think it's necessarily just humanity indefinitely. I think that when you this ideology, and I think you're correct to identify it as an ideology, it's something that tends to come up when you get large groups of people working in relatively complex societies where they don't understand the workings of the world in which they're operating, and so they respond by packaging their fear and ignorance as a hatred of the people who tell them how it's working. So I think that that's a, in that sense, it's seems to be something that happens regularly. Let me put it this way. I'm bothered by the idea that sometimes comes out in Hofstadter that this is just just American and it's just a, let's say, a post-war phenomenon. I don't think that's the case at all. I think that it's clearly got deeper roots. I want to give you another strain of anti-intellectualism in American history. During the antebellum period, a critical part of maintaining the institution of slavery was to attack not just the freedom of the press, but basically freedom of inquiry on a whole range of subjects. So to me, that suggests that anti-intellectualism is always to some degree going to be part of a system of oppression. The way in which you get large groups of people to participate in perpetuating a system that does not work to their advantage, works to the advantage only of a very few, is to get them to militate against those who would try to explain how their system works and how they can possibly make it better. So, in that sense, again, though, it's a kind of generic dysfunction. But I feel like I'm blathering on. I wish I had a better answer to this predicament. But I do think it's the central one in American history. And let's be honest, that's what we, you know, in the most recent election, that's what we've seen operating bigly, right? That we had, we have this just, not just a denial of knowledge, but a kind of hatred, sort of willful attempt to suppress meaningful knowledge, and that plays a huge role in producing deeply irrational outcomes.
Other than Hofstadter, has anyone done it, some more work on? I mean, that was 40 years or 50 years ago.
Oh no, but it's a big theme, and certainly there are plenty of historians who write about anti-intellectualism. There's a good recent book by Kevin Cruz at Princeton on. It's more about the making of Christian America. I can't remember the exact title, but he talks about, you know, the way in which, that's not quite anti-intellectualism, but it certainly shows some influence from that. But no, I mean, Hofstadter is very well regarded as far as I know, and you probably know better than I do, but I would say that it's an important factor. And by the way, Hofstadter also wrote about the 18th century and work that I used on the Great Awakening.
Other questions?
Thank you. First of all, Jonathan Edwards did die from the smallpox vaccine at Princeton, so I didn't know if he had an opportunity to look into that further. And this book I found interesting. I haven't read the entire book, but just going through parts, The Old Religion, The History of North American Christianity in a New World, Mark A. Knoll. It references Alexis de Tocqueville, and sorry if I'm mispronouncing, but are you familiar with references made to him, which is cited here? He paid his lengthy visit to North America in the early 1830s. The harmony between religion and liberty was one of the things that most impressed him. At a time when de Tocqueville's France was experiencing growing tension between promoters of liberty and promoters of Christianity, he found in America something quite different. The enduring religious legacy of the American Revolution was, in fact, what so impressed de Tocqueville. And just the final sentence here, quoting him, "In France, I had always seen the spirit of religion and the spirit of freedom marching in opposite directions. But in America, I found they were intimately united and they reigned in common over the same country." So I found that of interest to me.
Yes, well, this is very interesting, and de Tocqueville is used frequently to make this point. I think there are two important qualifications to make about that kind of interpretation. First, he's writing about America in the 1830s, in the midst of the Second Great Awakening. America in the time of the Revolution was very different. And I think most religion scholars will agree that certainly that was a low point in religious intensity in America in the Revolutionary period, quite different from what Tocqueville saw. A second point is that Tocqueville was relying on some of, you know, eyewitness stuff. He traveled around the country, but he was also interviewing a lot of American experts at the time, and he was to some degree parroting their views. And I think that they had an agenda, and if you look at some of the other sources at the time, you will come up with, let's say, a very different perspective on religion in America at the time. It's complicated, it's a very big picture, but one thing that always strikes me about Tocqueville, and I don't understand why he's not brought to task on this, is how he doesn't see what other commentators at the time, people like William Lloyd Garrison or Theodore Parker saw, which is that religion was particularly successful in the American South, and it was particularly implicated with and involved with the institution of slavery. The other thing that he doesn't seem to grasp is that in the North you had a greater diversity and a fair amount of controversy in religious sects. So the idea that there was sort of, you know, like one religion and everybody in America is happy and is able to reconcile this with liberty seems rather naive and hopeful. And I suppose more generally, there's another major historical interpretive issue that I think needs to be questioned here. I think there's an assumption that whatever happened after the American Revolution is a consequence of that revolution and is a consequence of the ideas and the ideals that are represented in it. And that's not true. I think that slavery is one case in point. It certainly happened alongside and it was certainly enabled by the revolution, but I think it's a mistake to say that it was caused by the revolutionary ideals in the American Revolution. And I think the same is true of popular religion. If you examine what many of our most famous founders expected to come out of the revolution in religious terms, it's not at all what happened. So the idea that, which I think Mark Knoll seems to be suggesting there, that yes, the founders had this vision that pretty soon there'd be a church on every corner and we'd have the American religious landscape that we got 50 years later. The idea that that's what they anticipated and wanted and projected is not true at all. I mean, Jefferson famously said that he thought that everybody in America who was alive when he was writing would die a Unitarian. And Thomas Paine basically thought that religion would essentially go away and pretty soon everyone would be worshiping nature. So you can't, I think, draw a very facile connection between America's religious experiment after the war and its revolutionary ideas.
Okay. We have time for maybe one, possibly two questions. Anybody have another question? None? Okay. Last question here.
I've spoken a lot, so if anybody else wants the mic, go ahead. Sprung to mind as you were describing the religious atmosphere of America. Is there any evidence or any going theories to suggest that the religious strands of the day, particularly when you talk about pain and this idea of worshiping nature, were in any way influenced by contact with indigenous peoples in the early or mid 17th century on?
Yeah, that's a very interesting topic, and there are a couple of good books that broach some of this issue. I can't remember the titles and authors right now, but they're good scholarly works. I wish there were more evidence on that to be able to make an informed judgment, but I think it's something that we should be open to. I mean, someone like Ethan Allen had a fair amount of contact with Native tribes. I mean, he spent time up there in the woods and negotiated that with them directly in some of his military adventures and so on. So I find it plausible to imagine that there was some kind of connection. Without at the risk of generalizing too much and stereotyping, I mean, there are certainly ideas that seem to come out of some of these Native traditions about the classic Great Spirit and so on that seems to be pretty much in tune with the pantheistic intuitions that are coming from the radical European Enlightenment. So it's certainly something that's worth exploring. I wish I had more to tell you in terms of real evidence, but I would certainly welcome that.
Okay, you're a big supporter, as I am, of primary sources and what the primary sources tell us. And I'd like to kind of conclude with if you wouldn't mind reading a passage from Washington where he talks about liberation and kind of the future, and if you could kind of tell us a little bit of the context of this quote. It's that one right there.
Oh, sure. This is certainly one of my favorites. So this is Washington, and he's coming back to public life in 1789. And he has a first draft of his inaugural address. And here's what he says in that. Though I shall not survive to perceive with these bodily senses but a small portion of the blessed effects which our revolution will occasion in the rest of the world, yet I enjoy the progress of human society and human happiness in anticipation. I rejoice in a belief that the intellectual light will spring up in the dark corners of the earth, that our freedom of inquiry will produce liberality of conduct, that mankind will reverse the absurd position that the many were made for the few, and that they will not continue as slaves in one part of the globe when they can become free men in another. So there are several important themes, and thanks for bringing up this passage, which I think is worth reading and rereading. But there's several important themes that we really should pay attention to. One is that he sees this as part of a global project, and so did they all. Jefferson thought it was the glory of America that we set the ball of liberty rolling, and when the French Revolution happened, they congratulated themselves for having set it in motion, and the French, by the way, also thought that they'd done them a favor. And it went farther and farther around the world, so they saw it as a global project. A second crucial theme is this one. It can sound platitudinous, but I hope that we all appreciate today when we face this anti-intellectualism, this kind of science denialism and so on, how important it is to put value in this freedom of inquiry that he talks about. It's not just a cliche or a platitude. I mean, this is really important, that freedom of inquiry is going to lead to a liberality of conduct that he talks about. And I guess the final thing that I think is really important here is he shows that this idea of freedom of inquiry and this global revolution is deeply connected with the idea of democracy. So, and this gets to the issue that I was trying to bring up in my ham-handed way and the two ideas of democracy. Sometimes we think of democracy as just whatever people's opinions are, and if you reflect their opinions, however imbecilic they are, you have a democracy. And he's saying there that no, in fact, you need to have this freedom of inquiry, you need to have a kind of liberalism in everything that we do, and that is the way in which the people can discover the truths that matter to them, and that's the way they can actually have freedom and actually rule themselves. Otherwise, you get populisms and fascisms and demagoguery and so on. And so he brings it all together in one passage that I think is quite beautiful and worth paying attention to.
Well, thank you very much. I think that is a great way to close, and thank you for spending the time with us.